CTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to Poets Pause. I'm your host, Marilyn Klimcho, and I'd like to welcome you to the program, invite you to come to First Thursdays at the Goggle Works at 6 o'clock to join Burke's Bards. And also, I'd like to turn off my phone, which is now beeping at me. The other thing I'd like to do is invite you to come to Second Tuesday, which is at Aladdin's in West Reading on Penn Avenue, Penn Avenue. That's at 6 o'clock, second Tuesday of every month. And that has that's a less formal setting. We usually gather, enjoy a meal together, and then share our poetry and talk, whereas First Thursday, we usually have an invited poet. So tonight, I want to introduce my guest by showing a poem that he set to animation.
Video.
In honor of one of his favorite poets, who was Emily Hayes Whittle. The poem is called The Limits of Reason, and I'm hoping that the control room would play that now.
This poem is entitled The Limits of Reason. After sweating in that hospital for 2 years following my graduation from LPN school and observing the directions the lives of my friends were taking, and after my fiance dumped me, claiming I was irrational because I would not give him more money for his education to become a logician, I'd had enough of that ennui town, and I found an old trunk that my great-grandfather had brought over from Ireland. I packed it full of my disparate belongings, threw it in the back seat of the car, and hit the highway north. I wasn't sure where I was going, just figured that road would lead me somewhere. Somewhere I might see my new self coming, hitching a ride. It was kind of peaceful, quiet at first, rolling through small towns as silent as cemeteries, contemplating the void. But then I began to hear faint rumblings from the back seat. I turned to see the lid of the old trunk slowly opening up and a variety of people and things emerging from its interior. The first voice I could distinguish was Dostoevsky stating that the opposite of love is not hate, but the persistent use of the rational mind. I saw my harmonica forging its way out to play. It began wailing lovesick blues. My lipstick jumped out, threw off its cap, and joined in. Baudelaire appeared presenting Rimbaud with a bouquet of fleur de mal. Sarah Teasdale was turning into a skylark and flew out the window. Rilke was writing letters to a young poet and addressing it to me. James Joyce was writing Ulysses and addressing it to God. Some damp handkerchiefs I hadn't had time to wash were giving a cold to Bob Dylan, yet he could still be heard rasping out, "A hard rain's gonna fall." Sylvia Plath was turning suicide into poetry. Novalis was standing on my box of Tide proclaiming,
Poetry heals the wounds
inflicted by reason. Thomas Aquinas was muttering,
Faith takes up
where reason leaves off. The mirror was looking for the last exit to Brooklyn, admonishing me to do the same, lest we be forever on this highway. Jean-Paul Sartre was howling,
There is no exit.
Allen Ginsberg was howling,
How?
The cacophony was getting to me. I was beginning to panic. Fears were escalating that I had somehow gotten onto the road to absurdity. I turned on the radio, seeking a word from the rational world. The nuclear alarm was blaring at 80 decibels, droning out the entire clamor from the black seat. Then came the indifferent, trained voice. This was only a test. In the event of a real emergency,
Stay tuned to this station
for further instructions.
So that was your video animation of Emily's poem, one of our local poets that you and I both, I have to admit,
this poem is entitled The Limits of Reason.
Have fallen in love with.
After
you're almost going to hear it again. Okay. So with me tonight is Naimon Lyons. He's a poet, singer, and songwriter, originally from Thompson, Ohio, which is near Route 20, you were telling me, which crosses the whole nation. He has two collections of poetry. I'm going to show up the starting lineup, which is from Foothills Publishing, and the one I actually have a copy of, which is Dark Franchises, also from Foothills Publishing. You're going to read some from each, and you have two original songs available on songcast.com, and you can see poetry and videos at his website, which is Naimon, N-A-I-M-O-N.org. I don't know if they can get in real close or not. Probably not. Okay. Saw it for a moment. There we are. So anyway, Naimon, tell me about what led you to make that video, why you find Emily's stuff so inspiring.
Well, first I'd like to thank you for allowing me to be here. I'm a big fan of Poets Pause. I'm a big fan of poetry, in addition to being a poet. And I'm a big fan of all forms of edifying and constructive creativity. And I think that everything starts off with the writing, and the writing is basically the poetry of it. But, I forgot, I would also like to start off by saying hello to my wife and our children and our grandchildren. You know who you are. And I love you. I think that when Emily wrote this poem, and I heard it, when you write something, you add one dimension to it. You have an idea that you make into an idea. When you bring it out into the world and present it to other people, you give it a second dimension. And then, depending on what the creativity is behind and what the actual structure is, I think it yields to adding different dimensions to it. And I consider it like putting meat on bones on a skeleton. Okay. So the poem just had such rich imagery to it. I thought that it would be nice to try to make it into a visual exercise. And I was working with a friend, and we started by, his wife has a photographer, and she had just bought a green screen. And so we said, he said he would borrow the green screen and we'd make it into a movie. So it was our first endeavor. I hope that you see how elemental it is, and it is a first effort. But it started, it actually got to something, to a point where I really am very happy the way it turned out, because we started out with pictures of the different people that she had referred to. And
right.
She went through a litany of historic, wonderful, artistic, talented people that, you know, it's very obvious that she has done some homework and done some reading and has is a very well educated, well-read person. And I just had to look up some of these people and to look up some of the things that they were saying that were speaking to her. And then as a result, try to get them to speak to us. And so that was our motivation. We started out with still pictures and then began to animate them. We started out trying to bring it to as much to life as possible.
Well, and the reason I brought you on is because over the summer, I've been learning how to edit video. And I've done a little bit of filming, videoing at Berks Barnes. And the issue I have with just doing that is that it takes, when I put it on film, it takes away the connection that I feel when I go to these poetry events.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like it cuts it right off. And so it's a whole different art to put something across on that little black box and make it engage the viewer.
No, I love to watch Sunday morning on CBS. And they always have at the end like 30 seconds or a minute of nature scenes at the end of it. And they had the people that make those segments on there, and they were saying that the guy did like 8 or 10 hours of filming to get to that 30-second segment.
To get that little bit.
Right, to make it perfect. So
yeah.
You film it, then you put it down in. It is a lot of hard work, and there are a lot of pieces that you think are great when you film them that actually don't fit into the final product.
Yeah.
Because you have to make it flow and make it be consistent. And
yeah, and we were like trying to figure out when you did this video, because you presented it at First Thursday back in, we think, 2014. And like I said, you haven't really done more with that. You've been taking your poetry in a different direction now and doing more songs, mm-hmm. et cetera. But let's go back to the poetry. Maybe you would like to read some?
Well, I would love to start out with something from my first collection, The Starting Lineup. When you start into video, mm-hmm. you really can't have enough equipment to do it. When I was working with my partner to do this, everything that we wanted to do to add to the feature pretty much required buying another software package to add to the program on the computer,
yeah.
in order to edit, in order to animate it, in order to give it voices. We have got a program for faces to add the eyes and then the mouth and then the voices.
To animate them.
So
yeah.
you have to, we listen to, have all these voices that you listen to come up with the different voices to add to it and stuff. So when you are starting out, you can do bare bones, but when you really get into it, you can spend as much as you on the programs to do some of those things that would be easily that you can't do. You don't even know that you can do it until you've gotten the program. Then it takes 6 months to learn how to use the program once you've bought it.
Right, and your partner on that project was Peter Mitchell?
Peter Mitchell, a good, very good friend. The production is called Fly and Maverick, and it's because Peter Mitchell, the character from Top Gun, Pete Mitchell, was Maverick. From my first collection called The Starting Lineup, I'd like to read The Poetic Voice. There has only and always been one poetic voice. Passion has been expressed, danger and anger and thanksgiving, forgiveness. And that never-ending love story filtered through the rocks of ages. The faces, the names, the dates, and the places have changed. Structure and tone and style may differ, but the single message remains the same. A heart pours out refined emotion into words and images to share intimate lessons and observations and feelings, and is somehow made lighter and begins to beat the magical rhythm of healing as thoughts are planted in the lives of an audience, drawn to the same spirit, by the same spirit, as if we have no choice but to obey the poetic voice. And I think that's sort of my statement of how, when you hear another person's expression, how it affects you. I recently saw where, on listening to the music channel on TV, they were playing Rolling Stones songs, and they had a little blurb that said they got the inspiration for the name of their band from a Muddy Water tune. So it's just like, I think everything builds on everything else. So it's important to share the creativity. It's important to share. And this community here in Reading has been our bards and this other group that you have. It's wonderful. Please participate. Share what you have. Don't sit in your basement and write and keep it in your notebook. Get out and share. There are kindred spirits out there.
Well, and you have not only done video, which I was impressed with at the time, and now that I've been doing video editing myself, I'm like really impressed. You are also a songwriter. Would you talk a bit about what it takes to create a song out of poetry? Because we actually have, Berks Bards has a song challenge, and the deadline for that song challenge is coming up at the end of the month. And I would love to have you talk about what it takes to write for a lyric that is so different from what it is that you do for poetry.
Okay, it's we had talked before about the statement that just bugs me about people saying that the movie is not like the book. And
yes.
I believe that, of course, they're not, because they're two different mediums. And the same thing applies to when I was a poet, before I started writing songs, I thought, how hard can it be? And I decided I wanted to write songs, and a friend got me a book. And of course, and the fact is that you really can't convert a poem into a song lyric. You have to write a song lyric. And the difference between poetry and song lyric is that, to me, poetry is an abstract feeling. And I thought that could be just sung, until I started working with my producer, who told me, songs are mathematics. It's all numbers. There are this many beats in the bar. You put those beats in the bar or get out of here.
So we're back to formal poetry if you want to be a songwriter.
You have to, everything that you say and think and do has to be on the beat.
And our song challenge is to provide about 5 lines, I believe it was, and they would inspire the songwriter. Mm-hmm. We have a guitarist who likes to do that, and she was going to use that as inspiration. But I understand now why she was only going to use it as inspiration, because you're right.
They gave the best example was "Beautiful Dreamer, Wake Unto Me." And that's why the Beatles were so good. Their songs are just right on, all of them are right on. And they're it's amazing. I was listening to Mr. Kite the other day, and they rhyme, you know, the horse will do the waltz. But the fact is that the fact that horse doesn't rhyme with waltz doesn't make any difference, because it has the same note and the same number of beats. It fits into the beat scheme. So it doesn't have to fit into the rhyme scheme. Of course, Harry the horse is going to do the waltz. It's great.
Yeah.
It works great. Yeah.
Well, let's hear some more of your stuff, because, you know, what's a poetry program without a poet?
Every once in a while. There are a couple of, it's funny how the creativity runs into schemes too. And I think poets have always been important because life, the things of human life haven't seemed to change over the course of time.
No.
I wrote this poem, this is in my Dark Franchises collection, called Hate. And the whole study is a poetic study in personal evil. But I wrote a poem called Hate that I'd like to do. Like the strangling weeds in the flower bed, I live to choke the life from everything I can reach. My mission is clearly destructive. I inhabit the breach. Keep you dangling over darkness, doubtful and suspicious. Grow wild and uncontrollably vicious. When you think you know me, I change. I am hate. I'm your primary motivation for isolation. When I get you to hate yourself, I get you to hate everything else. I let you embrace me naturally. And once I get my hold on you, I'll never set you free. I'm just hate. You embrace me naturally. And when you hate, you belong to me. Like the snare entangling the struggling beast, you can only tighten my grip. As I reach out to your outstretched fingertips, needing the darkness to hold on to, I'm just hate. When do you relate to me as well as you do? What do you expect? I'm just hate. The master of deception and neglect, when I get you to hate yourself, I get you to hate everything else. I let you embrace me naturally. And once I get my hold on you, I'll never set you free. I'm just hate. You embrace me naturally. And when you hate, you belong to me. You belong to me. You belong to me. You belong to me. I see this whole new cultural thing coming, this whole concept of hate, and coming along with it, the resurgence of
the
all the groups
political,
and this current political
environment.
Thing. And it's like, it's so easy for people to jump on the hate wagon, you know, and it's international, you know, like these people who, I mean, there has been a natural hate, there's always been an undertow of it.
Right.
But sometimes it's more brought out and it's so more acceptable.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to steer us away for a moment to the growing greener theme, which we threw out there as a writing prompt last month. And Vanessa Helms has contributed a poem that I thought was worthy of reciting here. It's called Daughter. You are my green child, my wild child, determined as a weed, infinite as a seed. You are the child who grows with her toes in the earth and her hair in the wind, filling the sky with tendrils of morning glories. The diggers of holes in the ground are your friends, the singers of songs in the early light your playmates. Go and be happy. Let mud cover your body and let your mind be filled with a million delicate roots. Let your heart be fireflies. That was very nice, and thank you, Vanessa. you're certainly getting a lot of attention, and we like your poetry. I'm going to tell you that the next poetry prompt for April is Showering the Flowers. You'll see the information pop up on the screen in just a moment, telling you where to send it. So if you would like to be a winner, send me a poem, and if it's selected to read on the air, you got a prize.
Excellent.
Can you share some more of your work?
This next piece I brought is called Victimology. Once again, right on time, the news, everybody is blaming somebody else for what's going on with them. I'm innocent, and it's not my fault. I have to learn to forgive myself and beg everyone I hurt to accept my sincere apology. I'm not who I appear to be. That's my victimology. I'm always at the wrong place at the wrong time. Is that a crime? I've wasted so much time. I'm oppressed, depressed, suspect, and stressed. Denied, deprived, and criticized. Get no respect. maligned, undefined, forced to toe the line. Show all those classic signs, highly evolved biology. That's my victimology. My constantly waking dream is a dynamic crime scene. Green room to silver screen, scream of false pretense disease. Pleading innocent, locked down struggle to be free from this life sentence of diverse segmented suppression and misdirected victimology. This is dedicated to, who's this, the singer in Chicago? That's current, I know his name is.
Oh, I'm not sure.
R. Kelly.
Okay.
Dedicated to R. Yes. Kelly, that he's such a victim. And I think I wrote this when Bill Cosby was going through his thing. It's just like, all these victims, and now all of the president's friends, they're all just innocent victims. I feel so sorry for their victimology.
Good one. we're running out of time, so I'd like to thank you for joining us tonight. Naimon Lyons has been my guest. I appreciate him coming. We heard the poetry of Emily
Whittle.
Hayes Whittle, and this is one of her books, Shadow and Light, which is available from Foothills Publishing if you're interested. I'd like to invite you to First Thursday and to Second Tuesday. That would be wonderful if you could come. Thank you.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.